Good morning and welcome to Asbury United Methodist Church. I'm so glad that you are worshiping with us this morning. And we are excited this morning. We are going to be having communion. I hope that you were able to get communion elements if you needed them, or that you have something with you, a piece of bread, some juice to take later on. We are also looking forward to next Sunday. We will be having in-person worship for those who would like to come, with all of the regular, now regular physical distancing and different elements that we know we need to, wearing masks that we need to keep in place to keep everyone safe. So we will be starting that next Sunday, the 13th of September. We are also offering outdoor worship on Wednesday, September 16th at 6:30 in the back parking lot. If you would like to come for that, we will have a wonderful time of singing and celebration then as well. If it is raining, we will get the word out and we will just move it a week to the Wednesday after that and hope for better weather. So hopefully it won't rain, but we would love to have you bring your own chair and you can come and worship with us. And that's Wednesday the 16th. I also want to mention that our communion offering today is going to the Life House. And if you would like to send in a special offering for our communion offering, market communion offering or love offering, and that will be going to the Lighthouse this month. So please do remember them as well. We are also continuing with men's coffee on Wednesday mornings, and the circles are doing their own meetings and things. We have yoga on Wednesday evenings at 5, and the garden club is meeting. The garden team is still meeting on Monday mornings. If you would like any more information about these events, please call the church office. We do have a new extension that you'll need to call at the moment. It is 624-1965. With all of the switching over, we've had a little bit of a snafu with switching our internet, so bear with us and thank you, but you can reach the church office by calling 624-1965. I'm so glad again that you are worshiping with us this morning, and let us now welcome the light of Christ. If you would now join us in our call to worship printed on your screen. Come out of the darkness of despair into the brightness of God's transforming love.
We praise God for God's presence with us.
Prepare your hearts and spirits to receive God's mercy and healing.
We thank God for God's mercy toward us.
Come, let us praise and worship God, who is always with us. Thanks be to God at all times and in all places.
Amen.
And now, if you would join in the opening prayer. Gracious God, we come this day seeking courage and hope for the future. Our world is in such peril. Heal these wounds and quiet the words of war. Help us to be those who bring peace in our families and communities. Banish the darkness of doubt and fear. Anoint us with your light and love, that we may spread the good news of your mercy to everyone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we come to the time in the service when the children come forward. If you'll come and have a seat right here, thank you for being here and for lighting the candles. And oh, it's so wonderful to see you. So today we have some familiar things and some things that are a little bit unfamiliar. Can you name something that maybe is a little different? Yeah, well, those did swap. That's right. The pulpit is over here right now, and the lectern is over here. That is very, yes, they did. And Phyllis swapped, too. She's now, how exciting, right? A little change is good. So you notice the communion elements, right? And that's kind of normal, right? We normally have the bread and the juice, and it's communion. And we also, do you know another name for communion? It's called the Lord's Supper, some people call it, and a fancy name for it is called the Eucharist. That's pretty fancy, isn't it? So we like to call it communion. So we are going to have communion today, but here's something a little different, and that is that we have everybody watching at home have their own elements. Now, when we have communion, I've got the elements for you up here. And they look a little different, too. Have you ever had communion like this before? No. So this is a little juice in a cup with a little wafer on it. And you open up the top of the first top, and you get the wafer. And then you open up the second one, and you can drink the juice. And this is for people, if you can have need to take communion somewhere, you can take it and have it. And so we have distributed some. If you wanted to come and get some, we also can have people at home can find their own bread and juice. Now, normally we don't do it that way, right? We have it all here for you, and that's the way we will get back to eventually. But here's the thing about communion. So we say, do you know what the juice and the bread represent? What does the bread represent? The body of Christ, right. What does the juice represent? Blood, they're right. Ooh, kind of, ooh, yeah. But, so what it is, we believe that when we say the words, what we call the words, when we remember Jesus on the night when he was betrayed, and that he took the bread and he took the wine, which we have juice, we say that when we remember these things, we know God is with us and with us as we take this bread and this juice. Now, here's the thing. It's a little bit mysterious. And so we don't always know exactly how that works, right? But we do say it's what's called a sacrament. And that means it's a very special thing. It is sacred. And so we don't just, we take it kind of seriously. And when we have communion, it can be a joyful thing, but it can also, it's also a very, we take it seriously because we say that God is very really present with us at this time. Now, God can be present with us at any time, right? But we know for sure that God is present with us as we take the bread, eat the bread, and drink the juice in communion, in this sacrament. And so that's why we take it seriously, and we know it, because God being right here, right now, is kind of a, oh, wow. Yeah? So it's a something that we take very seriously, but we also know that God can be present with all of the people who are watching right now and getting ready to prepare to have communion in their own homes right now. Can God be present there too? Absolutely, absolutely. So this is a, it's a mystery, and we say the mystery of faith. And so in this mystery of faith, we can trust that God is present. And so that is why we will later on in the service have communion together and trust that God is present in these elements that that people have gathered here and that people have gathered in their own homes. Will you say a prayer with me? Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for your love that is present with us in mysterious ways. Help me to share your love with others. Amen. Thank you for coming up. Thank you for coming forward. And we will share together a little bit later, communion together. I'd like to have the time of
First reading this morning is from Psalm 149. Sing a new song to the Lord. Praise him in the assembly of his faithful people. Be glad, Israel, because of your Creator. Rejoice, people of Zion, because of your King. Praise his name with dancing. Play drums and harps in praise of him. The Lord takes pleasure in his people. He honors the humble with victory. Let God's people rejoice in their triumph and sing joyfully all night long. Let them shout aloud as they praise God, with their sharp swords in their hands, to defeat the nations and to punish the peoples, to bind their kings in chains, their leaders in chains of iron, to punish the nations as God has commanded. This is the victory of God's people. Second reading today is from Romans chapter 13, verses 8 through 14. Be under obligation to no one. The only obligation you have is to love one another. Whoever does this has obeyed the law, the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not commit murder. Do not steal. Do not desire what belongs to someone else. All these and any others besides are summed up in the one command: love your neighbor as you love yourself. If you love someone, you will never do him wrong. To love, then, is to obey the whole law. You must do this because you know that the time has come for you to wake up from your sleep. For the moment when we will be saved is closer now than when it was when we first believed. The night is nearly over. Day is almost here. Let us stop doing the things that belong to the dark, and let us take up weapons for fighting in the light. Let us conduct ourselves properly as people who live in the light of day. No orgies or drunkenness or immorality or indecency, no fighting or jealousy, but take up the weapons of the Lord Jesus Christ and stop paying attention to your sinful nature and satisfying its desires. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of these words.
Thanks be to God.
This week, due to a glitch in the audio when we were recording my sermon, we are going to be using Brian's take on the sermon. And at the end, he invites everyone into some discipleship time. And if you're interested in joining that piece of the journey, then please do come talk to me. And so now enjoy the sermon preached by Brian Cornell.
Let us pray. Lord, quicken our hearts today to hear your call of love in our eyes. May we listen and be moved in our awareness of how we may better love our neighbors. Help us to wake up. Amen. I have found that I'm a little bit amazed by how much language can change in a very short period of time. I learned not too long ago longer than I want to admit. My classes that I took in Shakespeare as an English major told me that Shakespeare helped actually create words that were then added to the English language. And we understand now that he added over 1,700 new words to our language, including words such as upstairs, downstairs, puppy dog, amazement, and hurry. I think in the past 20 or 30 years, we have had several other new words that were common or that have changed meaning, and one of those might be tweeting. For if you're from my generation, tweeting used to be what Tweety Bird did with Sylvester when trying to get away. And now, of course, tweeting has a different connotation entirely. And so the pandemic has also brought in new words that we never knew. And for some of us, even pandemic is a new word. One of the ones that I'm more familiar with in this time frame is adulting. I wonder if you've ever heard of it. Apparently, if you wake up before 9 a.m., and if you shower, and if you put on any clothing that is not PJs or flexible clothing, then you have adulted, and you are to be congratulated for adulting in that day. Yes, that's a pretty low bar. Yet, our experience and general life as it is these days, it's a real thing. We're glad that people are adulting when they do. Now, of course, it used to be that we just aged and we, by significance of aging, became adults. But now we have grown people who may or may not be adults by the old definition, but exhibit adulting behavior based on what they're able to do or pull themselves into exhibiting in a day. My point being, it doesn't change what the word adult means, but it does change how we view it. In our scripture today, we are continuing our study of Paul's letter to the Romans, and we are also finding more words that Paul has added meaning to that would be outside of our natural understanding as a society. In our past few weeks of our study of Romans, Paul has reminded us that we are a part of a larger body, that we belong to one another, and that we each come with our own gifts and talents to be used for building up this Christ-like expression in our community. That's a mouthful, isn't it? Okay, here's the street version. You and I and those who are listening today, we don't exist for ourselves. We exist to serve and to serve with others. Here's the second part. Not just that, God has given us talents that are to be used to serve our larger community. Not just the church, not those within or outside of the building, although those distinctions have started changing, haven't they? Some of us have compassionate hearts to teach us all compassion. Some have teaching hearts to teach those in and out what teaching might be like. And others might have encouraging hearts so that we might be encouraged. And the list goes on. So today, Paul is addressing what we are to do about being the body of Christ and how we are to use these talents. And to no one's surprise, Paul thinks the time for that is now. But he uses a term that we would not have heard otherwise. He says it is now time for us to wake up. Now, I could pinch myself, and I'm pretty sure nothing would change. Ow, okay, except just that my arm hurts. But I think I'm already awake. So what is Paul getting at? Paul is using the terminology of being awake as something more than just happens in the morning after we have no longer been asleep. Paul's encouragement to wake up suggests that there is an immediate need for us to be aware of our surroundings, and in being awake, we will now be able to love the way that we are called to love through Christ and God. The scripture then goes on to name some of the important things about being awake. And here I'm quoting from the Message, which is a paraphrased translation of the Bible, and it reads, "We can't afford to waste a minute. Must not squander these precious daylight hours in frivolity and indulgence, in sleeping around and dissipation, in bickering and grabbing everything in sight. Get out of bed and get dressed. Don't loiter and linger, waiting until the very minute. Dress yourselves in Christ and be up and about." I think Paul might have also coined, at least in a Christian way, another version of adulting that we could use in our congregations today. He wants to see us Christian adulting, and that is being awake and about and doing the work that we've been called. So how do we respond to this type of call to be awake? How do we distinguish upon those who are awake and those who are not? I think it has something to do about being aware. And unfortunately, as I adult, I find that it leads me to things that make me not more aware, but less. Not too long ago, I was playing I Spy with my youngest. And he said, "I spy with my little eye something orange." Now, if you're familiar with the game, of course, it means he has seen something orange and it's your job to figure out what it is. So I went to all the things. I said, "Is it the traffic cone? No. Is it the sign on the mailbox? No. Is it that little bit on the edge of that very cool license plate? No." I went through maybe 10, 20 different scenarios, and finally I said, "I think I got to give up." And he goes, "It's your shoelace." Sure enough, when I looked down, not only was it orange, but it was untied. And at some point, I was going to need to pay attention to this so I didn't have other problems. I think sometimes that we forget how to be aware of the very things around us because we're so used to the big thoughts or maybe being concerned of other things. Paul's call to awareness asks us not just awareness of our surroundings, to whom we are addressing our message, but also to think about how we come into these spaces, because each space requires its own preparation. We couldn't be more aware of that now than ever, we could not be more aware of that now than we are because of the changes in our protocols of how we come into places to keep it clean, to protect others, and to keep ourselves safe. And I think it means, though, that we need to enlarge also our sense of awareness so that we are aware of racial inequities and ways that the justice system affects people differently. There are places where Paul's call to be awake and loving our neighbor invites us into new understandings of people and systems around us. And even if we think we don't agree, which is fine, to at least be willing to sit with them and see it as they do, to be awake to their own surroundings and their reality. In all of these places that I'm naming and others, they come out of our desire to love our neighbor. That is why we are doing it. We don't come and bring our own culture with us, but rather say, let me come to you and see what the world looks like from where you are. And Paul leaves no question in the verse today. He says, love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. So I ask you and I ask me, where is love calling you to wake up today? Is it to lay something down? Is it changing your own behavior? Or perhaps is it to pick something up, finding new places of understanding for someone in our lives? I want to invite you who are taking this word very seriously, and I hope you are, to consider joining with me this next month on a discipleship journey that I will be doing by text or by Facebook. It's open certainly first to all the members of our congregations, but it goes beyond that. It's open to members or friends that you might have or family. It's not limited even to expressions of Methodism. But it does have four components, and that is to think about how it is that we love the Lord our God with heart, with soul, with strength, with mind, with four habits that we practice each week. At the end of the week, each Sunday, we reflect on how it went and then retool it to go back at it again. And much like Paul encourages us, we do it together as a body, inviting those who are there to just encourage and to be an affirmation point for all of us, awaking and trying to do something new. My experience in Christianity as well as in life has led me to think that to create big steps, you first have to learn to take the small ones. And the same may be true of learning how to wake up. Sometimes we need to just commit to the smaller steps that lead us to being able to be aware, to practice awareness in our lives. And the good news, both for those who will take on this discipline and for all of us listening today, is that we have a community here and a body of Christ that walks alongside of us, and that they offer their gifts so that we don't have to do this alone, and those who can teach can teach, and those who preach can preach, and those who encourage can absolutely encourage. The challenge is most likely, if we take these steps of discipleship seriously, it will involve change, and everything I know about change, even the stuff I'm looking forward to, is there's usually some form of discomfort. But by now, I hope that we all realize God has not promised comfort, but rather something even better, a fullness of life and living for others, so that in their finding the fullness of God's love, we all find a satisfaction beyond our wildest dreams. It is God's call to each of us, because now is the time to wake up. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
We've come to the time in our service where we bring our gifts and our offerings to God. We also know that we offer ourselves as living sacrifices, and so we bring the gifts that God has given us for ministry as well. And so now let us praise God through offering our tithes, our gifts, our offerings. And now we've come to the time where we join together as we celebrate Christ's sacrifice for us. and join together in this meal that we have. And so I hope you have your bread and juice ready, or your communion elements that you came and got from the church ready for you today. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. And now we'll continue with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good to give thanks, to give you thanks at all times and in all places, O God. Through your living word, you created all things and pronounced them good. You made human beings in your own image, persons capable of entering into relationships with you and with each other. Through prophets, rabbis, and teachers, you have sought to be in loving relationship with us, even when we have sought to go our own ways. When we have brought others pain and heartache, you offer us a way of reconciliation. So today we join with all of your people on earth, praising your name in unending song, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and throughout, and on these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. The bread that we break is a sharing in the one body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the one blood of Christ. And so now, those of you who are at home, I'll invite those that are here to come forward, and I invite you to prepare. We will eat and partake of this meal together. And so that means that as we, it's actually a kind of a neat thing we can do. We will all partake of the bread together. So go ahead and open your bread and have it ready, and we'll eat the bread together, and then we'll drink the cup together. And that actually symbolizes some unity in our one body, and that we are the body of Christ together. This is the body of Christ given for you. And now, if you will open the juice part of it, and get your juice together, and know that this is the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Go in peace to know and love and serve God in all that you do. And now, if you would join in our prayer of thanksgiving. O Holy One, we give you thanks for this mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to share ourselves and your love with others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We join together now in our time of prayer for our nation, for our world, for all the people in our congregation. We do want to lift up Pat Nelson, who had surgery this past week, and she is recovering, but please do continue to lift her up. We want to pray for Kendra Sharkey and her family. Tom, her husband, passed away last week, and so we want to lift them up in prayer. And we also want to remember Roger and Cheryl Perindo, and Roger is facing surgery as well, and so we want to lift them up in prayer too. We, of course, remember our nation, the leaders of the nation, the leaders of the world, doctors and others who are at the forefronts of trying to find a vaccine and fighting the pandemic. And so we want to lift up also the other civil unrest in our country, and just remember, just lift them up to God's hands, lift ourselves and our nation up. And so we will begin with a moment of silence, and then we will join together in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, we come to you this day and we lift up our cares and concerns to you. We come and bring our whole selves as offerings for you. Help us to love as you have loved. Help us to find the time now, today, and each day to be people who care for one another. And so as we come to you, there are many places that are on our hearts that we lift up to you. We pray for those who are sick or recovering from surgeries or sickness, that they might have your healing. We pray for places in our world and in our nation where there is violence. We pray for the well-being of all people. We lift up those who are facing hunger or poverty, that they might have your provision and abundance. And we lift up people who are walking in darkness. They might have your hope and your light in their lives. May we be that light and hope each and every day, so that as people come to know us, they come to know you. We pray all of these things in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now receive the benediction. Now is the time to go forth with love in your hearts for all people. Go in peace. Thank you.
Thank you.